Hello and welcome to episode 33 of the Learning and Teaching at Newcastle University podcast. My name is Ben Steele and I'm going to do a quick introduction for this episode. In today's episode, we have part one of a conversation with Matt Laidler and Dan Graham from LTDS. They speak to Dr. Adam Potts and Dr. Chris Graham about their Canvas courses and essentially, as the title suggests, the pedagogy of Canvas. This is a two-parter and there's quite a lot of information, so I'm just going to hand over straight to Matt.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the LTDS podcast. My name is Matt Laidler, and I'm joined by my colleague, Dan Graham.
Hello, I'm Dan Graham.
And we are Learning Enhancement and Technology Advisors in the Learning and Teaching Development Service. We advise people on best practice for Canvas. We organize a lot of the training, and we're here today to talk to two academics who've done some really interesting things with their Canvas courses. If you want to introduce yourselves.
Hi, everyone. So I'm Chris Graham. I'm a senior lecturer and I'm also the director of digital learning in maths, stats and physics. So I'm a keen Canvas user, but I also work with our digital learning team to support teaching and learning of mathematics through the use of technology. So we develop tools like the Numbers-y assessment system that you might have heard of, and a tool for accessibility as well. So yeah, great to see you.
Hi, everyone. My name's Adam Potts. I'm a senior lecturer in philosophy. I'm also the co-director of education for School X. So in that role, I've been thinking about digital education, some of the practices that are being talked about at the FEC. And in the previous role before that, I was the DPD in philosophy as well. So kind of had an oversight of the program and trying to think about what, you know, the Canvas looks like for philosophy as well. So, yeah.
Fantastic. Okay, so I guess the first question, which I think will be relevant for a lot of people now that we're sort of approaching that point in the year where things are starting to wind down for this semester a little bit. How do you plan for designing your courses in Canvas? How do you kind of approach the design phase of planning how you're going to run a course with Canvas?
So when I'm thinking about sort of designing my courses, I'm really thinking about, first of all, starting from from our school's Canvas blueprint. So here I'm thinking about those elements that we need to ensure consistency for. So how students find that key information. So the assessment information, the syllabus, contact details, that sort of thing. So that sort of forms that sort of baseline. And then I'm really thinking about how students who are entering my Canvas course are flowing from the homepage to get to their learning material, to whatever it is that they need for that week's content or that teaching session. And I tend to do that through Canvas pages. So I'll talk about that, I think a little bit later in more depth. I think more generally, I really am thinking about building my module almost from Canvas up, if you like. So thinking of Canvas first rather than the lectures. So Canvas is sort of that home for, you know, announcements and course material. It's really if I think about a week's content, it's the first connection that I have with students will typically be an announcement saying, you know, I've released this week's material, and they have all that sort of in front of them, rather than my first contact being in the lecture and saying, this is what we're covering this week. And by the way, there's some material online. So I'm really thinking about sort of building up from Canvas upwards. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I guess some overlap, maybe some little differences as well. I mean, I do have, and yeah, I'll talk about this maybe in the next question. I do have a template for modules that I kind of roll over on the year that I think have worked quite well. So I always have that in mind. Like Chris was saying, I think the homepage is really important. So I've tried to kind of rethink this year, and I've actually used a kind of intro. I did a module video. Intro to the module that I put in the home page rather than text, and that's been a nice placeholder. But I guess a little bit different from Chris, I guess my Canvas design comes out with the course design from lectures. So in the existentialism module I do, for instance, I have three themes that I group the weeks through. So the themes are nihilism, faith, and hope. And I have certain topics, certain thinkers that are associated with those themes. So that kind of thematic structure of the module feeds into a module map, which I use using the module handbook. I display in lectures, I put a key points on Canvas, and that module map, that thematic route, essentially allows us to organize the material on Canvas. And then I start thinking about, okay, well, which material beyond lecture slides or seminar questions for specific topics deal with those kind of thematic issues, and where would I want to place them? So the depending on the module, the organization of that module, that'll feed into the Canvas design a little bit. So similar to Chris, but slight difference there.
That's great. And I guess we'll start with you for this one, Adam, then. So you mentioned a little bit about this. So how do you organize the content within Canvas then?
Yeah, on the homepage, I trialed this year using module intro videos to sort of talk about the aims of the modules, not just in terms of the MOF, but in terms of, you know, the specific topics that will be covered this year, the assessment, the structure, the learning expectations. And then in the module sections, yeah, like Chris, I'm pretty much using the pages, but I have a template that I go through. So, and it's quite close to the kind of default template that's offered by Canvas with some tweaks. So I always have a weekly overview section, and in that I always have two items. So the first, I have a session intro video. So I record this on PowerPoint. It's normally about 5 minutes. It's introducing the week. It displays the module map. It talks about the aims and objectives. And it talks about what they need to be doing that week to complete the session. Then following that, I have a planning your time section that just breaks down the timing. And that's always put in line with the MOF. So it's always a bit of a guessing game how long it might take a student to read a chapter. But you might say, okay, this is going to take you an hour and 20 minutes. You've got a 5 minute intro video. Spend 20 minutes with the seminar questions and jot down some answers. So I always start with the weekly overview. Then I have a pre-work section, which is always like either read or a watch. So with philosophy, there's always normally set reading each week. As I say, sometimes I might include some audiovisual content on there. So what I did with existentialism when I was introducing the themes, so if it was the first week on nihilism, for instance, I did a nihilism intro video, which was about 15 minutes long. And that would kind of give an overview of what that concept is, the theme, how it relates to the thinkers. And I'd roll that over each week for every thinker dealing with nihilism as an optional content in case they missed it. Then following that, I'll have the lecture and seminar material. So I'll try and post the PowerPoint slides in advance. I normally just use PowerPoint. I'll embed the recap in there from the recap page as well, so they can go from the slides into the video once that's recorded. And I always try and post the seminar questions with aims and objectives in advance as well. Then the weekly wrap-up section at the end, as well as summarizing the session, those module maps that I was talking about. I mean, this is an idea I stole from my colleague, Rosalind Beaumont, from years ago, and I've just never left it, by the way, so I can't claim it. But the module map that just talks week when materials will be out, what the topics are, when the online materials are available, I display that in the wrap up every week so they can see what's kind of coming up next and what's, yeah, where we've been, where we're going. And that's a nice kind of feed into the following week.
Yeah, very similar sort of philosophy to Adam in terms of ensuring that students have, you know, that material easily accessible to them. I'm a big fan of Canvas pages, and I sort of take the weekly overview that we have in the blueprint. I sort of take that and run with it. So I normally call these a weekly dashboard. I call them dashboards, and I'll usually create one for each week of content. Now I'm lucky, I think, that my content sort of quite naturally falls on weekly new topics. I think I'm lucky in that respect that it makes it very easy to organize material on Canvas. So I will have one of these sort of weekly dashboards for each week, and I usually link those directly from the homepage, making the current week the most prominent link. And on that weekly dashboard, I use a very similar philosophy to what Adam was talking about there. I'm really presenting everything that the student needs, basically in trying to make that one click away. So on that page, I have the aims and objectives of that week. I have the learning material. I do what Adam does in terms of trying to set expectations around the time that students will need to spend on different pieces of material. I think that's a really good idea. So embedded, usually an embedded sort of introduction to the week's content, similar to what Adam was talking about. Zoom links, the timetable for the week ahead in terms of when are the lectures, when are the office hours, formative assessment links. Just a sentence, when is your next assessment? Is this date here, or here's how to find it? So really I'm thinking about when students enter my course, they're one click away from that weekly dashboard, and then just one more click away from whatever it is that they're looking for within that week. So I'm really thinking about that that flow. So yeah, some similarities, but I use I'm a big fan of Canvas pages and so in creating like tables and getting everything laid out so it's easy to navigate. Yeah.
So how do you make sure that your course, I mean, it sounds like you're doing way more than the baseline, but what advice would you give people to make sure that their course is kind of meeting the baseline, and how do you ensure that you do that?
Yeah. So in terms of ensuring that meet the baseline, it's very tempting taking that approach with Canvas pages. It's very tempting, for instance, to hide the modules page because I'd like to encourage students down the pages route. But actually, I don't do that. I try to stick to our school's blueprint as closely as possible as sort of the base, so that students have a consistent experience across. So if that is what they're used to in other modules, they have that as a route in my own. And I think in terms of the Canvas baseline, it's really primarily it's sort of that blueprint level that I think in our school, we get a lot of those blueprint items ticked off. And so actually my involvement with ensuring that we meet the baseline is more about being involved with the design of our school's blueprint. So we sort of think about the guidelines for the baseline, but also about student feedback. So what we get through module stage evaluations and that sort of thing to help steer the content of that. And then during the academic year, we'll then ensure that we sort of have compliance with that baseline by including looking at Canvas courses as part of our peer observation and sort of stage level overview of what's going on in Canvas courses. Yeah.
I think what Chris mentioned there is really important in terms of, you know, thinking about baseline in terms of learning and teaching within your unit. And I think that's where we've really, well, where our focus in philosophy as well. I mean, because we know Canvas does a lot of the work for us in terms of recommending baselines, and it is good at catching a lot of that. But yeah, thinking about what that looks like in terms of signposting, learning objectives, thinking about what that looks like in terms of PowerPoint displays and accessibility of PDFs and things like that. I guess maybe something I do individually, which feeds into this, would be things like the mini intro videos and the module maps, which are just these, I mean, you know, you don't necessarily have to be doing them on a module. It's not to say a lot of that content isn't covered, say, in the lecture or in the handbook or something like that, but it just gives students a variety of materials and ways of engaging with some of those key things that are essential to just accessing a module. Without too much repetition, trying to kind of diversify how you present certain information seems to be working quite well in terms of the stuff I've been doing.
Fantastic. And that kind of pulls nicely into the next question I wanted to ask, which is, you briefly touched upon the concept of accessibility. And I think that's something that is obviously really important for us as a university to make sure that all our materials are accessible. So how do you go about doing that? How do you go about making sure that, you know, your Canvas courses are as accessible as possible?
So, obviously looking in the design phase around PowerPoints and videos and things like that, looking at some of the baseline in terms of, you know, the baselines that have been offered by LTDS and trying to follow in line with that, you know, captioning videos. Although when I did do this in Microsoft Stream, I did a caption once and I was teaching Dada, an early 20th century movement, and it translated it as doo-doo. And I only caught that late into the module and realized students had been laughing at us. So it's not always foolproof, but yeah, keeping an eye on things like that. I think, like Chris was saying, having kind of peer observation, learning and teaching committees where you're sharing good practice, and mid-module surveys. I think getting a sense of what students are finding in terms of accessibility or not, because I mean obviously we have these baselines and templates that we can use, but you know, each student's different, and it's getting a sense of what they found accessible, what they found perhaps not, and trying to respond to that in real time as well. So the mid-module surveys have been quite important for capturing that.
There's lots of important things that Adam mentioned that I'll not repeat. And I definitely won't go into some of my other caption stories, which not be appropriate for your podcast. Accessibility in maths is a real challenge, actually, because we tend to write material using software that goes beyond, you know, your Word and your PowerPoint, so typically in maths, lecture material is prepared using typesetting language called LaTeX, and it's LaTeX will typically produce a PDF, which is not very accessible. So actually, this is something that our digital learning team in maths, stats and physics have picked up on, and we've actually developed an external tool that integrates with Canvas. It's called Chiron, and so in my modules and many of our other modules in maths, we use this tool to present material as an alternative to just uploading a PDF. And it produces it takes a LaTeX source code, this typesetting language, and it produces an HTML, a website output that is it's very accessible, along with a PDF version and other flexible ways to sort of digest content. And so that's our main thing to add, really, that we have these sort of extra issues in maths that we need to accommodate, and that's been our approach, and that's all sort of integrated in with Canvas as an external tool.
Fantastic. So again, just for Chris then, so how do you use audio visual materials in Canvas? How do you integrate that into your practice?
So in terms of AV, really, I'm really thinking here about, you know, the recap videos, whether that's the lectures that have been recorded or videos that are pre-prepared. I think Adam mentioned earlier on about embedding those video recordings inside Canvas pages. I think that is a really nice thing to do from a couple of perspectives. It's one less click for the students to go and find that video, but also keeps everything together. So, you know, so for Adam, if he's going to have a video introduction on a topic, there's no point in having that video, you know, stuck in a folder somewhere. It should be right there with the material itself, and I think that's really important. So I do that on my weekly dashboards where it's relevant. One more thing I do, which is an overhead, but I do like to change the titles of my recap lecture recordings from the default that you get into a more readable date, the lecture number, the topic that was covered in that lecture. It only takes a few seconds to do from the sort of recap page inside your course. And yes, it is a pain to remember. I usually have a calendar and notification, weekly calendar notification remind me. But I think it does make a big difference, you know, in terms of students being able to find, you know, looking back for, we know that students use these recordings for revision. So, you know, when they're going back to that material, seeing just a bunch of dates is not very helpful. So being able to pinpoint what they're looking for, I think, is very helpful. So that's one more hint that I do, but it does have that additional overhead of work. Yeah.
One thing I have found in terms of audiovisual stuff for something like philosophy, I found it's really good for essay writing tips and guidance, because I always find when you deliver that live, it's always quite a dull, dry session, and you get the death stare sometimes from students. So it allows you, it frees up a week where you can be teaching content or you can do something a bit more engaging. But it also just gives them material that they can kind of dip in and out of, whether it's referring to the questions or really specific essay writing stuff. So I always try and do that on a module every semester and make sure I embed that in one of the weeks.
How do you integrate Canvas into your teaching practice?
So, there's the integration in the kind of much just traditional sense of set reading before lecture and making sure the content's on there. But I think, these little additions in terms of introductory videos maybe related to thematic issues or essay writing, it starts to pull Canvas into the teaching as much more of a resource and a tool. And I think, you know, signposting that early on in the lectures and communications, that it's not just a kind of file dump where they go find reading. It's a place where there's other resources. One thing, although it's a bit challenging to maintain sometimes, I found it worked quite well during COVID, was to have discussion boards on certain content as well. So this felt like there was a bridge between each lecture. We weren't just waiting for the next lecture or the seminar. So I guess that's the main way, really, really indicating what the use of Canvas is for students on the module quite early on.
I will often start off lectures with a tour of what's new on Canvas. I think always thinking about that, you know, link from Canvas to lectures and lectures from Canvas. I think, as Adam says, it's really about making it feel like, you know, it's a home of the module rather than just something that's just on the side and an added extra. Yeah. For my practical sessions, for my modules, I'm using tool I talked about earlier to embed sort of those worksheets right inside Canvas, you know, so it really does feel like that's the home of their material. Yeah.
And that seems like a good place to stop for this episode. You've probably noticed that our episodes are monthly now. However, for this episode, we're going to release part two next week. So thank you to Matt and Dan from LTDS and Adam and Chris. We'll hear more from them next week.